Luke, look this with me. It simply says this. Now upon the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they came unto the sepulcher, bringing the spices which they had prepared and certain others with them. And they found the stone rolled away from the sepulcher. And they entered in and found not the body of the Lord Jesus. And it came to pass, as they were much perplexed thereabout, behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. And as they were afraid and bowed their faces to the earth, they said unto them, why seek ye the living among the dead? He is not here, but risen. Remember how he spake unto you when he was yet in Galilee, saying, the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and the third day rise again. You see, that passage of scripture right there has the absolute hope of all humanity hung on it right there. He is not here. That changes everything in history, church. That changes everything from the Old Testament. That changes everything from the law that was laid down, because nobody could fit the law. Right. And by him coming and hanging on that cross and that tomb being empty on that third day, you have hope.
Right.
You can live under the grace of a holy God, because you could not live under the law.
Right.
Because first and foremost, the law wasn't meant for you. Mm-mm. It was meant for the Jewish nation.
Right.
It wasn't meant for us. But when that centurion looked at that cross and said, truly, this is the Son of God, the Gentile nation was given hope.
Yep. Amen.
So what kind of hope? What does this mean for us? How does this change my life, preacher? How does it change who I am? How does it change how I am? What does this mean for me? What does this mean for you today? I hope it means everything.
Yeah.
But if it doesn't, let me share something with you. I've had a line stuck in my head all week. Mm-hmm. As Austin and I have shared different things this week, and I've shared with different people. Everybody's been in the same mentality this week. God is doing something in the life, something that man needs to stay out of.
Yep.
Because man's only going to hinder it. As I would try to write some notes and pin some things down this week, he wouldn't let me write anything. He said, because if you write, that's man getting involved. I just want God's word preached this morning. I just want God's word laid out this morning. And no chapter in the scriptures defines how. Listen to this. In that great song, Because He Lives, we sang it just a few minutes ago. One of the greatest lines in that song is, I can face tomorrow. I can face tomorrow. And in this world we live in now, this perilous world that we live in, what greater line is there than I can face tomorrow? So how do I do that? What leads me to do that? Romans in the 8th chapter. If you want to turn over there with me, you can. I want to give you just a couple of things out of this passage of Scripture to help you face tomorrow. We've all got plans for tomorrow, don't we? Everybody, you know what you've already planned for tomorrow, what you've got going on tomorrow. We're all got busy days planned tomorrow. Some of you say, I'm not getting out of bed until 10 o'clock, preacher.
Amen.
Some of us saying, I'm getting up way before then. Some say, well, I'm going to get up, but I ain't going to do nothing.
Amen.
See, everybody's got a different plan for tomorrow. But let me tell you something right here. Let me show you something in God's word that can help us face tomorrow. Let me tell you, the first thing you want to see in the very first verse of that 8th chapter of the book of Romans, look at this very first verse, and this ought to make you shout, church. Listen to this. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit.
Amen.
There is now, I want you to hear something, church, you can face tomorrow because you are not condemned to die.
Yes.
You can face tomorrow because you are not condemned to death by the sin that is in your life. Had it not been for that empty tomb, you would get up tomorrow facing the condemnation that waited on you.
Yep, that's right.
You would be condemned to death without any hope. But through what Jesus Christ did,
yes,
through what the scriptures teach us right here, there's life in Jesus, and that's how we face tomorrow.
Yeah.
I hope you can face tomorrow and you understand that condemnation, because listen to this. If you have not accepted Christ as a personal Savior, listen, that condemnation's still real.
Yep.
That condemnation's still real. You've got to say, preacher, I got to come to know Christ today. Because I don't want to be condemned to death. I don't want to face death and eternity separated from a holy God. That's what the resurrection means. He is not here so that you could have life.
Yes. Amen.
Isn't that good? Isn't God's word good?
Yeah.
But not only does it give you life, not only does it give you life, it gives you something great. It gives you a family. Look at this. Look with me over just a few verses over in verse 12. Not only do we have a life, we have a leader. Look at this. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live after the flesh. For if you live after the flesh, you shall die. But if you through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the body, you shall live. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father.
Yep. Amen.
We cry, Abba, Father. Look at that. Isn't that great? The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. And if children, wait a minute, if children, then heirs, heirs of God, joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together. When we see that, we have a life that without condemnation, but we also have a family. If we're born again in the Spirit and we're led by the Spirit, that makes us sons and daughters of God.
That's it.
Sons and daughters of God. And if you're a son of God, that means you're, guess what? You're brothers with Christ. The Bible says, joint heirs. That means you're brothers. Did you know Jesus was your brother if you're a born-again child of God? That could give you hope for tomorrow, couldn't it? How do I face tomorrow? Because my brother's already there, and my brother's always got my back.
That's it. Amen.
Ain't that the way it looked? That's what you think about brothers here, isn't it? Isn't that what you think about family here? You can count on family when you can't count on anybody else, can you? You love your family. You say, my family's great. I love my family. I don't have a brother. I got a brother-in-law. Might as well be my brother. Been a brother-in-law for about 40 years now, I think. 50, something like that. He's getting old. He's getting old. But you know, we've been family for a long time. And when you're family for a long time with each other, you begin to love each other, don't you? You begin to overlook each other, don't you? Did you know what? Christ is your brother, but he still overlooks your faults.
Yep.
He overlooks your faults. Whatever I got for tomorrow, and you know what? I'm going to get up in my faults tomorrow. But listen to me. I'm not going to get up in condemnation. I'm still going to get up in my faults.
Yep.
Because I'm not perfect. And I say this quite often, but I'm going to do it again today because we got a lot of guests and visitors today. Anybody perfect? Matt's perfect, Lee. He's going to mess the rest of us up. Because if anybody in here is perfect, you don't need Christ.
Right.
And if you're in here and don't need Christ, something's wrong, and you're going to mess all us imperfect people up. Because there's nothing perfect in me except Jesus Christ.
That's right.
That's the only thing that's perfect in me. But you know what? That's enough. That's all I need. So because he was not in that tomb when those ladies got there, when Mary and Salome, and they all got to the tomb and they realized he wasn't there, he is not here. And because he's not there, I can face tomorrow with a brand new life. I can face tomorrow with a brand new family.
Yep.
Because I am a son of God. And I have a leader that leads me as a son of God. If you leave me to lead myself, I'm in trouble. Because I get lost in la-la land when I try to lead myself. I get over here and I get thinking about something else. Next thing you know, I'm lost. You know, you ever got lost? Anybody? Let me tell you, I'm going to blame this on John. John's fault, right off the bat, okay? I was driving a church bus Wednesday evening. And I picked up John. I'm not blaming it on Josh and Jesse, it's John. I picked up John first. So we started back toward the church, and instead of going our route to pick up everybody else, I was just coming back to the church. Finally, I realized, wait a minute, I'm supposed to go the other direction. And I said, John, why didn't you tell me? He said, I didn't know where we was going either. He said, I knew we weren't going in the right direction, but I wasn't sure where we was going. I said, you can't count on people. But you see, I lost all my perfection right there. But you know what? Can I tell you something? If we're led by the Spirit,
yep,
He will absolutely never, ever lead you in the wrong direction.
That's right.
Never.
Yep.
And as we've said so many times, His will not carry you where His grace cannot protect you.
Mm. Amen.
Isn't that good? Isn't that a great thought?
Mm.
So not only do we have a life, we have a brand new family. But listen to this. Austin said it a while ago when he finished up that great recitation. We win.
Yeah, right.
We love to win, don't we?
Mm-hmm.
Anybody here that just loves to lose? If you are, man, you're warped. Something's wrong with you, okay? Nobody just wants to lose. What does the Bible teach? Let's look. Look with me, verse 28. I love this passage.
Mm-hmm.
Listen to this. Therefore, excuse me, and we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to His purpose. Look at that. For whom He did foreknow, He also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of His Son, that He might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom He did predestinate, them He also called. And whom He called, them He also justified. And whom He justified, them He also glorified. Look at that. What shall we say then to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? If God be for us, who can be against us? But let's go a little further. You want to? Look. He that spared not His own Son, but delivered Him up for us all, how shall He not with Him also freely give us all things? Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? And it is God that justifies. Who is He that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea, rather, that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through Him that loved us.
Amen.
For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor power, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Amen.
What a passage of Scripture that is,
yeah,
church. What that means is, if God loved us enough to send His Son, God loved. Can I tell you something? That predestination, that ain't got nothing to do with salvation, all
right?
Because let me tell you something. God wants everybody to be saved.
That's
He
it.
Sent His Son to save the whole world, okay? But it says that there's an important word in there that tends to get overlooked when people look at that. And that word is called.
Yep.
I don't care. If God may have me predestined. I don't know. But I'm going to tell you something. When He called me, I had to answer.
Right.
When He called me through the power of His Holy Spirit, I had to say, okay, I will.
Yep.
And when I said, okay, I will, that's when He began to do a work in my life.
Mm-hmm.
All that other stuff, it don't matter to me, okay? But listen, I am a conqueror,
yep,
through Him. We love to conquer, don't we? When you go out on a mountain and a trail or anything like that, you love to walk that thing all the way to the end. And when you get to the end, no matter how high the mountain was, you got there and you conquered it, didn't you?
Mm-hmm.
You defeated it. When we get little things in our life, a test or thing, you kids at school, when you get a test, that's a mountain in your way for a short period of time. And as you climb that mountain and you conquer that test, you win, right? Mm-hmm. And we like that. It's a great feeling to win, isn't it? Well, let me tell you something about this love of Christ. The love of God through His Son, Jesus Christ, says that we're going to win. And it says that we can absolutely never be separated from that. In other words, listen to this. You're saved by grace. You can't separate yourself from God. You may try. You may want to. You say, I want to separate myself from this God. I don't want to do this anymore. He loved you enough to send His Son, and He will hang on to His.
Yep.
So because He's not in that tomb today, because it's a resurrection day that we celebrate, today is Victory Day, church. Today is celebration day. Today is the day that your life began.
Mm-hmm.
Brand new life because of what Jesus did.
Yes.
Brand new life because of what Jesus did. And now you're a winner. Mm-hmm. You got a brand new life. You got a brand new leader. And you are a conqueror through Jesus Christ. Listen to this. Through Christ. Y'all ready? Y'all ready for this? I don't know if y'all can handle this or not. Some of you can, some of you can't. Through Jesus Christ, you have beat death, hell, and the grave.
Amen.
You beat it. You won. You conquered it through Him. Can't do it in yourself.
Nope.
That's one you can battle all day long. You are not going to win. Christ Jesus won it for you, and when you believe what He did, that's your victory.
Yep.
That's your victory, because all things work together. All the perils of your life, all the troubles of your life, everything you're going to face, it all works together. For those, you got to get this verse, for those that love God, but those that are called for His purpose. Church, I'm telling you, God's got a great purpose for you. And I want you to hear this, church. We've got visitors here this morning. Thank y'all for being here. You're not here by accident. You're not here by chance. You're here by divine appointment this morning. God had a purpose for you this morning. Mm-hmm. And it was to be here and worship with us today. And we're so thankful for that. So this morning, victory's ours. That victory was won at Calvary. And because He is not here, and we didn't have to lie about it, we didn't have to tell a story, you got victory. You know what that is? That's truth. That's the truth of God's Word. And God loves each one of us today.
Yep. Amen.
God loves each person standing here, sitting here, all in this room today. God loves you. Not only does God love you, the one sitting beside you loves you. You say, I wonder about all that. Well, can I tell you something? If we're in Christ, the Bible says we love each other. We're all on the same team. Have you ever seen a team? Have you ever looked or saw a team that played together as a team? That team wins, doesn't it? But when you got that one out there that says, I'm going to do it all, I'm going to be the showboat, that team usually loses, don't they? We're all in this thing together, church. And together, we are joint heirs with Christ, and we are conquerors. I love that. In just a few minutes, we're going to partake of the Lord's Supper. And I want you to understand something this morning. The Scripture is very clear, 1 Corinthians in the 11th chapter and the 28th verse. That before a man partake of the Lord's Supper, he needs to examine himself. He needs to look at the things in him. He needs to see where he stands with Christ. He needs to see where he's at. You got to see those things. When you examine something, that means you look at it, right? You look very closely. So this morning, as we get ready to just have a song of invitation this morning, as we get ready for the Lord just to work in just for a minute this morning. Listen, there may be somebody here that doesn't know Christ as a personal Savior. You realize, I don't know it. Or you may be here this morning and you realize, boy, I've been separated from him for a while. I've tried everything I could to separate him. But let me tell you something. If you've ever accepted him, you can't separate yourself from the love of God. He loves you. You say, I just need to do a little business with him this morning. I need to come back to the fold this morning. You may be here this morning and you say, I just need to spend a minute with the Holy God today. That may be you. I don't know. But I'm going to ask each and every one as they come to the song this morning, before we partake of the Lord's Supper.
244.
I'm going to ask you to stand with me, and I'm going to ask each one in this room to examine themselves. And Lord, I just hadn't lived to that expectation. Lord, I just hadn't lived to what the Scripture teaches. I just need to come back to a place of you today. It's not about me. It's all about you today, Father. And we'll sing a verse this morning. And you let the Lord work in your life this morning. As they sing, as the Lord comes and he moves and that Holy Spirit flows from breast to breast, just let him. Let him today.
Just as I am.
Just as I am. Just as I am this morning. You've been obedient to the Father today. And as you take your seats this morning, ask the deacons if they would come prepare the table this morning. Visitors, please hang around and partake with us this morning. Let us spend some time with you. We all know as we study Scripture that as Jesus spent time in an upper room with his disciples, after they had finished their Passover meal, Jesus took and he shared some special moment with them. Not only did he share in a special moment, he was doing what Jesus does best, did best, and still does today. He was teaching in a moment. And as he taught those disciples, he said these words. He took bread and he broke it and he said, "This is my body, which do in remembrance of me." So church, as we come this morning, as we partake of this communion, remember, this is his body. And remember, it was broken for you. It was broken for you this morning. sir.
Let's pray again.
Father God in heaven, Lord, we thank you so much. Lord, as your word teaches us, Lord, as that lamb was led to the slaughter, Father, we thank you for the body that was broken that we might have life. We thank you, pray in Jesus' name. Also that night he taught the disciples. He said, there'll be a New Testament. He said, that New Testament will be my blood that's shed for you. Sir, Bible teaches without shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. So we thank the Lord this morning for that precious blood that ran down that cross. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you, Father, for the blood that was shed. Lord, that blood that was shed for me, that blood that covers a multitude of sin. But Lord, that blood that was shed willingly, Lord, we thank you so much for that today. Thank you, pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And then the Bible says, after all that, they sang a hymn, went out into the garden. We're glad you're here today. I hope you've received something today that can help you, something that can make you better, something that can just make this next week just a little bit better. But listen, if there's something that can't, I pray you find it today. And that's that man called Jesus, okay? as you stand with us this morning. No service here tonight. I hope you enjoy the rest of your day with family, friends, whatever you've got planned.
Mr. G, what are we going to sing as we head to the garden?
Fifth verse.
Fifth amazing verse of Amazing Grace. All right.
Praise God.
Thine, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty. For all that is in heaven and earth is thine. Thine is kingdom, O Lord, and thou art exalted as head above all. Both riches and honor come of thee, and thou reignest over all. And in thine hand is power and might, and in thine hand it is to make great and to give strength unto all. Now, therefore, our God, we thank thee and praise thy glorious name.
Church this morning, a beautiful Easter morning. If you missed sunrise this morning, you missed a blessing.
Amen.
Thank you for the 80 that was in Sunday school this morning. And again, if you don't have a Sunday school class, we got one for all ages. Birthdays, we have Addison Wingo on April the 6th, Leanne McKenzie on April the 7th. Is anyone out celebrating a birthday this week? Is anyone celebrating an anniversary this week? Leanne, I guess you're on your own, huh? April 1st is Easter. Danny Armstrong offering is taken up this morning. You do not have an envelope. We got some right here. If you need an envelope, we'll get one to you. April 16th, Sunflowers meet at 6 p.m. Uh-oh, I done skipped one. April 14th, bake sale at the Dogwood Fair. Proceeds go to the building fund. And we'll also have two floats in the parade. The Sunflowers are building a float, and the church is building a float. Need your help on that. Tuesday, April 17th, 7 seniors are going to Somerville to the flea market. The bus is leaving at 7 a.m. sharp. So if you want to go, don't be here at 7. They're leaving at 7. If you can't get here at 7, you'll be left. Sign-up sheet is in the front if you want to go to that. And April the 29th, Youth Sunday, Fifth Sunday night singing here after church. See any other announcements that we don't know about at this time? Well, I don't have a thought to carry with you this week, and I thought Miss Gail was just going to beat me down yesterday when I told her I didn't have a thought. But I do have a spoiler alert for you. The tomb is empty.
Amen.
Let me tell you a story.
It's no ordinary tale. No, it is the ordinary from which every other story hails, because you see, it's the story of God, the story of history. And I'm not the author. No, the author is a glorious mystery, because long before he would put his pen to the paper, or long before there was time or there was matter, he was there. All alone, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, one God in three persons, eternal in existence.
Amen.
He was completely satisfied, needing absolutely nothing. He was happy in himself, and his joy was overflowing. The Son in the arms of his Holy Father, the Spirit overshadowing all, glorifying one another. So why then would this God create the fountain of all happiness? Can you improve upon this state? Well, the joy within himself welling up at such capacity had to be shared with a glorious society. So the mighty author, quill in hand to share his infinite mind, his love, his joy, sat down to write his once upon a time. So in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and he made all things to reflect his beauty and his worth. Mountains, rivers, oceans, trees, all gladly testifying. Stars and galaxies declare his glory shining. He made it all, and it was good, and to culminate his work, he fashioned man and breathed to life his special ball of dirt. Well, man woke up with blinking eyes and was welcomed by God's face. They walked with him every day and night, and there was peace and no such thing as shame. God says, be fruitful and fill the earth and eat from any tree, except this one, because if you do, you'll surely fall from me. So why do this and why give this choice? Because he's writing a story, and he's going to use it to show the whole world the fullness of his glory. Conflict enters pretty early on in the script, with a snake in the garden doing what he does best, running his lip. Flashback to when this evil was created. He was an angel of heaven who fell when his head got inflated. Banished from God and his unending mercy, he came to earth to tempt us with the unworthy. So in the garden on an ordinary day, the snake came to Eve and said, did God really say that you should not eat from every tree in the garden? He must not want your happiness, or you would have total freedom. So pridefully they listened. Sinfully they took and scorned their creator. Injustice. This, my friends, is injustice. That God should be seen and then treated as a nothing. That man should forfeit his joy and dig for fleeting pleasures in the gutters of this world. Fallen now is all mankind, and sure to face his judgment. A world of pain, toil and strain, and hell forever after. But the plot continues. We get some character development. All supporting actors, all fantastic as embellishment. Noah finds favor in God's holy sight, and when God sends his flood, he mercifully preserved his life. We come to Abraham, and God makes with him a covenant. I will bless you and make your offspring abundant. To Isaac and to Jacob, God would come and do the same. And though many dangers came to threaten his perfect plan, the story would go on with the author's full control, and he would lead his people everywhere that they should go. Flash forward 400 years. Now in Egypt, there's a Pharaoh who doesn't like God's people growing numerous in freedom, so he made them slaves. God comes down and chooses his servant Moses, a burning bush, a call to go. His presence is his promise. Go now and tell that Pharaoh to let my people go. That way they can worship me in a place that I will show. Plagues numerous. God shows that he is the I Am. That Pharaoh's rule is nothing but a pawn in his glorious hand. The waters part, the millions leave to follow their great Savior. He guides them, provides for them, even though they're so ungrateful. At Mount Sinai, God gives them the law, so perfect and so pure. But God's people soon find out that they cannot obey these rules. They try, they fail. Compelled to live in sin, they would bow to worship God, and then they bow to idols again. They say to God, give us a king. That will make things better. God, their rightful king, assures them this will be a fetter. But they insist that God relent and gave to them their kings. Some were good, brought them to him. Most brought idolatry. God would send his prophets. Turn back to God. Sometimes the people listen, but mostly they just gave a nod because they all just wanted to be him. God will not wink at your sin, the prophets would all say. The people rose to eat and drink. They left to go and play. It finally seemed that God had had enough and brought a blaring quiet. The prophets ceased. The people waited 400 years of silence. Enter our protagonist, mostly unannounced. The plot is quickly rising now. Who is this guy? Nobody really knows. He's meek, he's humble, not your ordinary hero. But see, the craziest thing about this character is, we see he is the author himself. Right. His name is Jesus. He was born of a virgin. Fully God, he was perfect. Fully man, he was learning. He made the lame to walk. He caused the blind to see. And unlike the religious leaders, he had some real authority because he came from on high. And he came not to serve, but to be served by his haters and his enemies. He was different from all the others, but tempted just the same in every single way we are, yet without a single sin. He loved, he gave, showed us the heart of the author. And he claimed no glory for himself because he came from his Father and we hated him for it. Because we all wanted to be God. Despised and rejected, we esteemed him not. Conflict escalating now. It starts with a betrayal. Judas whores his eternal Lord for 30 pieces of silver. A final meal, a prayer, and then they head into the garden where Jesus would sweat with drops of blood preparing for our pardon. The soldiers took the Lord away and led him to a trial. Are you the Son of God? They say, I am. There's no denying. Except, of course, for his disciples who leave their Lord in fear. Jesus looks up to the sky. He would be all alone from here. They lead him to the praetorium and then begin to beat him. Who hit you? They would shout and say, oh, Father, please forgive him. They made his back a bloody mess. They whipped him till he lost his breath. They threw the cross upon his wounds, the weight of sin, 300 pounds. The great eternal Lord of all, the author of all things, now like a lamb led into the slaughter, would this be his defeat? They nailed him to the rugged cross. They shouted out, where is your God? Have you forsaken me? He takes a breath. His final three. It is finished. The Savior's cry, and he bows his head. The author of life, the Lord of all, the Son of God, is dead. They laid his body in a tomb, and then everything went quiet as God's people find themselves again in everlasting silence. 2 days pass, and on the second morning after Jesus died, Mary went to the tomb to take a look inside, and when she arrived, she was met by an angel. She fell to the ground, but he said, there's no danger. This Jesus, is he the one you seek? Mary, he's not here. He is risen indeed. Climax is true. Every good story has one. It's the part where you begin to feel a slight shift of momentum. Mary sprints to go and tell the disciples, the Lord, he's alive. He's alive, just like he promised. Peter and John go to see for themselves, but there's nothing there. They said, perhaps he truly lives. Jesus' words come flashing to mind. They will kill the Son of Man, but after 3 days, he will rise. Amen. Momentum is surely building now. The enemy is limping. Jesus finds the 12 and gives to them the mission. All authority is mine, all in heaven and on earth. Go and tell them I'm alive. Go and tell this whole wide world. And don't get slack. I'm coming back. Acts now, the church is born, the Holy Spirit given. The news of Jesus like the most contagious sickness spreading. Thousands saved, a mighty wind is blowing through the region. The promise that God gave to Abraham, yeah, we're finally starting to see it. Thousands saved, a mighty wind is blowing through the nation. God's gift to Abraham, we're finally starting to see it. Repentance and forgiveness preached. All in the name of Jesus. Saints and sinners alike proclaim, our God has come to save us. Gentiles hear the story and the news is blowing up. The plan is working. The gospel spreading from Asia to Africa. Martyrs laying down their lives because they know this story is true. It's a story like no other. It's a movement you can't undo. Constantine tried to slow it down and turn it into steeples, but an angry monk from Germany wrote some holy gospel thesis. It spreads like fire, and then it comes to America by sail, and here we are in the 21st century because the gospel cannot fail. It's the greatest story ever told. It's the greatest story ever told by the greatest author this world has ever known. But there are some still left to go. Yes, there are some still left to go. Because you see, go is the command to every tribe and every nation and carry this great story to this dying generation. Because when this gospel finally spreads across the whole of earth, we'll hear a trumpet sound and Jesus will return. Heaven will be open and a white horse shall appear. The one who sits upon it, all of his enemies shall fear. His eyes will be like fire and his purpose will be glory. Justice for all evil and life for all who love this story. He'll come to judge the quick and the dead, and all of this world, every knee will bow and tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord.
Amen.
Death and hell he will throw into the lake of fire, and Satan too, that coward foe, that serpent, that old liar. The church will rise around the throne, clothed in glory his. With every nation, tribe, and tongue, we will worship him. And singing, worthy, worthy is the Lamb who has been slain. Blessing, honor, and glory forever to his name. And for ages and ages we will sing the praises of our God and King. It's the greatest story ever told by the greatest author this world has ever known. Yeah, the bad guys lose, the good guys win. Jesus is Lord of all. The end.
Amen.
Yeah.
Thank you.
young people come up here. We're going to sing the first now. God
sent His Son.
Thank you.
3:11. It can happen any moment.
It could happen.
outstanding. Austin did a great job. Brother, you're going to ride your bench up here or something. Look at that. How many of y'all remember the day, some of you say I still do, when you had one of those corded phones in your house? Y'all remember that day? You had those phones? Let me ask you this. How many of y'all have ever done this? When that phone would ring, the first thing you started doing is to the one that answers, going, I'm not here. Tell them I'm not here. I don't want to answer. Tell them I'm not here. So we got a luxury now when your phone rings, you can see who it is. You're going to talk to them, don't answer. But see, we would lie. We would say, I am not here. Well, can I tell you something? There's a word in the scripture today that is not a lie. June, they can call me mentally ill all they want to. But I'll tell them I'm stark raving mad. Because you know what the word says? He is not here.
Yes.
And that word is so powerful because that word is so infectious that it changes lives because he is not here.
That's right.
In the book of Luke, in the 24th chapter, I'm just going to read a passage of scripture there, and then I'm going to turn somewhere else. Because I'll tell you something, church, if he was there today, you wouldn't be here.
Right.
If he was there, you wouldn't be here. You'd have no reason to be here. You'd have no cause to be here. You'd have no cause to sing. You would have no cause for the Word of God. You would have no cause for anything. You would be dead. But because he is not here resonates in the hearts of people and in the minds of people, he is not here gives us hope for our life.
Yes.
And that life that Jesus said is so abundant. 24th chapter.